If you are a developer or tester, you are probably working with APIs. Depending on your project, you might have to deal with tons of different API routes. And since each route requires different methods and header rules, it becomes hard to test them in the console. That's why most developers use an API client. There are many options out there, but the most popular one is Postman. It was developers' favorite API client for years, but they started adding too many features which made it slow and bloated. It takes a long time to open and it consumes a lot of resources. And it gets worse as you add more requests and collections. Speaking of collections, when you open the application, this screen shows up. And you cannot add or save collections and variables without creating a cloud account. And I know many people don't want to share their projects and secret API keys on a cloud platform. If you choose the lightweight version, you can just send a request and see the response. That's all. Postman is still a great tool and I'll keep using it for advanced projects that need its unique features, but most of the time I just need something simpler. I tried some other alternatives, but they either don't have a good user interface or they are too basic to handle larger projects. I tried some VS Code extensions, but again, they ended up making things complicated. So recently, I switched to Requestly. It's for free and open source, and it doesn't force you to create a cloud account. If you watched my previous tutorial, you saw me using Requestly to test the endpoints of my e-commerce application, and it worked seamlessly. It's really lightweight, it consumes fewer resources, and lets you quickly start creating your workspace, collections, variables, and API requests. All of them and your history is stored locally. If you already have a Postman or Bruno project, you can easily import them with just one click. And the best thing is you can install its browser extension and start testing your APIs right inside your browser. You can also manage your API requests easily using this extension. So let's take a look at our API client with an example and explore some useful shortcuts. You can easily create collections to organize your project. Let's say we have a social media application that includes the admin and the client APIs. We can also add child collections to separate our routes. I'll add some examples quickly. Let's say users, posts, and logs. And for the client, let's say we have the authentication route and the user posts. We can see all our collections here. Now you can make a request. For example, in the admin panel, we can fetch all the users, or we can fetch a single user. And on the client API, users can create a new account. So let's say register. And let's say login. And since we'll be sending data to backend API, we'll use the post method. I'll do the same thing for the register. And after the login process, users will be able to fetch the posts from their friends. And now we can write the endpoints to make requests. So I'm gonna write my API URL, but instead of writing the same URL for each request here, we can create an environment variable. So I'm gonna create a new one. Let's say my environment. And here I'll add the base URL and paste the value here. You can use this value across all your APIs. But let's say we have different URLs for the admin API and the client API. In this case, I can select each collection and create local variables. Its port number will be 8001. And for the client API, it's gonna be 8002. And now let's open our request. And here I'm gonna be using curly braces. And as you can see, our variables are here. I'm gonna choose this one, and the endpoint will be users. And to fetch a single user, we are also gonna need the user ID, let's say 1. But the better way is add here a path variable and update the ID using that variable. Let's do the same thing for the client API. I'm gonna choose my URL. The endpoint is gonna be register. Here is gonna be login. And this one is gonna be posts. So let's create a new user. Since we are sending a data, I'm gonna choose body, and I'll send my data as a JSON object. Inside this object, we'll have the username, email, and the password. I'll send, and it's successful. Let me show you my API, and you are gonna understand better. Here we get the data, and create a new user, and in the login, we get the username and password, search for this user, and if the user exists, we create a JSON web token and send it as a response. And later, using this token, we'll fetch all the posts of user friends. If there is no token, we'll send this error message. So let's login. I'm gonna copy my data. Again, I'm gonna choose JSON, paste the data, but we don't need the email. Let's get rid of here, and send. The token is here. Now, using this token, we can fetch the user posts. So I'm gonna add my token here. I'll choose a bearer token, and paste it here. But every time you want to test your endpoints with an authentication token, you have to copy and paste this again and again. To prevent this, we can use requestly scripts. As you can see, we have two options. We can run a script right before making a request and right after receiving a response. They basically allow us to customize our API dynamically using JavaScript. So we can manipulate the request, change the variables, and test the responses. So what I'm gonna do here is, I'm gonna take the token from the response and assign it to a variable. So let's get the response body first. I'm gonna transform this into an object. And after that, I'll say, if the token exists, set it as an environment variable. To do that, again, we'll be using the request object. With this object, we can access and modify the API request, response, and all the environment variables. So I will use the environment, set a new variable, its name will be token, and the value will be the token that comes from the response. And now, whenever I log in, it's gonna automatically update the token variable, and we can use it in the bearer token. In this case, instead of adding here a token, we can use our variable here. Let's send, and our items are here. Another good use case for a script is pagination. For example, if you are using a pagination or infinite scrolling, instead of changing this number each time, you can add a variable like page number. And now we can assign a value to this variable before making the request. Let's say page number, check the variable. If it exists, use that number. If not, start from 0. And we can increase this number before each request. And now every time we send a request, we can see the next page. This is the page 1, page 2. And since the total number is 10, we'll not see an item in the third page. This is how you can use scripts. You can also use them for the test purpose, but before, let's take care of the admin. For each request, we have to check the authorization first, because only an admin can make a request to any of these endpoints. So if I'm not an admin, I'm gonna see this error. But instead of writing token for each endpoint here, we can just add an authorization rule for the parent collection. I'll add the admin token. And now, for the children, instead of selecting a bearer token, the authorization type will be inherit from parent. And now, we can see the users. So let's see how to test our responses. Again, I'm gonna choose script, and let's test the response of this endpoint. After getting the response, again, we'll be using the request object. I'll create a test. Let's write a test description. And here, we'll add the assertion. The response should have the status code, and the value should be 200, which is successful. I also want to make sure that it returns the desired data. So let's test if the response includes the items array and this total number. I'll give the description. It should have a JSON body, and it should include a field called items. I'll do the same thing for the total number. And now I'm gonna send. As you can see, there are 3 tests, and all of them are successful. There are many other assertions you can use to test your API. You can find them in the documentation, or you can even ask the built-in AI chat. Requestly includes everything you'd expect from an API client. I think it's a great alternative to Postman. It's free and open source. It doesn't require a cloud account, and it's super lightweight. I highly recommend you give it a try. Okay, that's all for today. I hope I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.